If you have your Bibles with you today, we will be in the Gospel of John, chapter 14, beginning with verse 25, and then through chapter 15, verse 17. The scene here is Jesus in the last evening with his disciples before he went to the cross. They had had that Passover meal. Excuse me. Okay, I think I'm ready now. He'd had that last Passover meal. He had shared with them the cup and the bread. He had washed their feet. And then he began to explain to them those things that he had been explaining to them all along, but in a more deep and significant way, talking about how his relationship with the Father would now become a part of what our relationship is with him. If you look in chapter 15, verse 10, or I'm sorry, 14, verse 10, we'll get to 15. He said, "Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own initiative, but the Father abiding in me does his works. Believe in me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. Otherwise, believe because of the works themselves." He'd been saying this all along to them, that his relationship to the Father was one of perfect unity. What he did, the Father did. What he said, the Father said. And so once again, he goes along those lines. But then he adds something that is very significant, if not shocking. If you go down to verse 23 of chapter 14, Jesus answered and said to him, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our abode with him." He says to him at this point, this relationship between the Father and I now, and he's beginning to describe what the Holy Spirit is going to do. He's going to go, but another must come, the Holy Spirit of truth, and says, from that point, he and the Father, will come to live in you, and it's a joined relationship so that their relationship will be linked to that unity of the Father and the Son through the work of the Spirit. When you stop to think about this, excuse me, it's astounding. Can you imagine those disciples sitting there at this Passover, and he's telling them, okay, this is basically it. I'm going to go. And they're trying to come to grips with that. And then he says, but it's good that I'm going to go. Because if I go, the Spirit's going to come, and that's going to open up something brand new. You know that relationship I have with the Father? You will now be included in it. And this is one thing we must realize as believers in Jesus Christ. Our faith is not just an intellectual assent to a creed and a doctrine, to saying, yes, I agree with that. I choose this one as my Savior. It is a living relationship in union with the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit that is of oneness. It doesn't mean we become part of the Trinity. We aren't gods. But we are invited into their intimate relationship as they begin now to do God's work in us that Jesus was doing when he was here, in the same way Jesus was doing it when he was here, through that intimate union with the Father. So that is where we left off last week when he looked at those things a little bit. Now we're going to start at verse 25. And he begins by talking about the Spirit. He says this, chapter 14, beginning with verse 25. "These things I have spoken to you while abiding with you, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I've said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled, nor let it be fearful. You heard that I said to you, I go away, and I will come to you. If you loved me, you would rejoice because I go to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. Now I have told you before it happens, so that when it happens, you may believe. I will not speak much more with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. He has nothing in me. But so that the world may know that I love the Father, I do exactly as the Father commanded. Get up, let us go from here." The first thing we learn when he's talking to us about in this intimate relationship is something important about the Trinity. There are explanations of the Trinity here in John's Gospel by Jesus that we have nowhere else in Scripture. And we learn here about the Trinity and us. And the first thing we learn is the Holy Spirit makes it all possible. Without the Holy Spirit, it is impossible. It is impossible for us in and of our own strength and flesh to be in union with Christ and that intimate with Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But by the power of the Spirit, we become able. That's the importance of Pentecost. That's why everything changed at Pentecost. That's why Jesus told his followers, don't do anything. You're going to be my witnesses. You're going to make disciples of all nations, but don't do anything until the Holy Spirit comes. And that's when it all began. It is the Spirit that makes it all possible. He says, the Father will send the Spirit. And the Father will send the Spirit in the Son's name. Now, we hear that a lot, in Jesus' name. We are supposed to pray in Jesus' name. And sometimes we relegate that to a phrase, to say in Jesus' name at the end of every prayer. Let me enlighten you into something. You can pray and say in Jesus' name, and that prayer may not at all be in Jesus' name. And you can leave off that phrase, in Jesus' name, and that prayer might be entirely in Jesus' name. Because what it means to be is in Jesus' name is in his authority and in his will. So the Father is sending the Spirit with the authority and in the will of Jesus Christ. That's why the Spirit, we are taught in Scripture, never glorifies himself. He always glorifies Jesus. Always points to the Son, because he has been sent by the Father in the name of the Son, in the Son's authority and in the Son's will. So praying in Jesus' name is to pray under the authority of Jesus and in his will. And we're promised if we are praying in Jesus' name, our prayers will be answered because they will be his will by his authority. To pray in the flesh is not to pray in Jesus' name. I can pray for a brand new Cadillac and I can say in Jesus' name on the end, and I likely have not prayed in Jesus' name, unless that's what he wants to do, but I don't think so. So the Father sends the Son in Jesus' name, and he says, he will teach you all things and bring all things into remembrance. This has a two-pronged significance. One has to do with the very scripture that we're reading right now, because when he says, the Spirit will bring to remembrance everything I've said, that had to do with those apostles. The Gospels came through the apostolic testimony. They were either written by the apostles themselves or their right-hand men who had access to them on a regular basis. And the Spirit brought back all those memories for John to write all these things. But even more than that, he is the one that opens our hearts to know and understand. Paul talks about in 2 Corinthians how the veil must be lifted for us to even see the truth of Jesus Christ. That's the Spirit's work. He opens our eyes and opens our mind to learn those kind of things so we can understand and read this Bible and hear the voice of God, as opposed to someone who might just be reading this Bible and say, this is really a weird old book. It is the Spirit who opens our eyes for those things. And ultimately, what he says at the end there is, I give my peace to you. The Holy Spirit living within us is the one entity that can truly bring peace to our lives, because the very presence of God has invaded us. And we have the ability, with our eyes opened and the veil removed, to see the big picture. And when you see the big picture, that brings peace, because the turmoil of this world is not all that significant. It is temporary, and it is also under God's divine control. That prevents us from going nuts on what's happening in the world and becoming greatly fearful and panicky and do foolish things because something must be done or this world's going to pot. Well, yes, what must be done is God's will. And no, this world is not going to pot. This world is going exactly along the lines that the Master of the universe is directing it towards his perfect goal and his perfect plan. And you know what that gives us? Peace. I don't care who's president. Well, I do as an American, but as a follower of Jesus Christ in his kingdom, I don't care who's president. I don't care what laws are passed, because those things are not what's significant. What's significant is the kingdom of God is advancing. He is building his kingdom. His Spirit is at work in those who are united with him and doing his will. So the Spirit is the one that truly unites us and gives us that hope and opens our ears and opens our eyes and opens our hearts to understand. Now, what does this say about Jesus? I'm talking about the Trinity in us. Well, we go on to chapter 15 and hear these words. Now, he says, get up, let us go from here. He may have given this discourse as they were leisurely walking out towards the Garden of Gethsemane. It was that night. We don't know for sure, but it seems that way. He says, come on, let's go. Here's what he says. I am the true vine. My Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away, and every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it, so that it may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit, for apart from me you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away as a branch and dries up, and they gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. Just as the Father has loved me, I have also loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be made full. Is this thing popping a lot, by the way? Let me move it away from my mouth a bit, see if that helps. So here we have Jesus saying, here's how he is in this Trinity and us business. He is the vine, we are the branches, we must abide in him. The word abide, it literally means remain. What it means is, very clearly in the context, is be attached. The Christian life is not just agreement with creeds, it is an attachment to Jesus Christ as the vine, and we are the branches. And what he tells us very clearly is only in him can we bear fruit. The fruit that we bear, the things that we do that are good things, the good works that God prepared beforehand that we are to walk in, we can't do them on our own. They can only be done by the power of Jesus through that connecting spirit. So in that case, we can bear much fruit. In fact, it goes on to say, if you abide, you will bear much fruit. It's not a potential at that point. If you are connected, you will bear fruit. If you want to hear a double negative, you cannot not bear fruit. If you are connected to Jesus, you cannot not bear fruit. It is impossible. If there's no fruit, there's no connection. Because if you're connected, from what he says, you will bear not just fruit, but you will bear much fruit. And he goes on to say, answered prayer will be a part of that abiding. Why? Because we will be praying in Jesus' will, because we'll be connected to him. We will have inside knowledge of who he is and how he thinks and what he desires. And so that our prayers will become less selfish prayers, less, Lord, give me a Cadillac, and more, Lord, give me a love for that person that I'm struggling to love. That's a prayer in Jesus' name, by the way. We pray that sincerely. He's going to answer that one. And also it says, in so doing, in bearing this fruit, we will prove to be his disciples. Is there an outward proof that you're a disciple of Jesus Christ? There's no mark that comes on your back when you become a Christian so it can pull up shirt tails and see who's really a believer. But it does say you want the proof. It's in the fruit that you'll bear. Now, what is this fruit? We can do a study of an entire sermon or entire sermon series on what that fruit might be. We know there is the internal fruit of the Spirit, those changes within us that makes us more loving and joyful and peaceful and patient and kind and good and gentle and all the rest of those. That is, yes, that is part of that fruit. Absolutely. There is the fruit of the love we have for one another, which he tells us in his last talk with the disciples over and over again, is the sign of my presence, the way you love one another. And those two things, by the way, that fruit of us changing in the way of loving and joyous and gentle and patient and good and kind and all those things, and loving one another will draw people into the ultimate fruit, which is people coming to Christ and entering this very same union with the Father and the Son through the Spirit. All that is fruit. He says, this fruit is the proof that you are my disciples. Jesus being the vine. And it also tells us that those branches that do not bear fruit will be pruned. They will be cut off. Branches that bear fruit, I'm sorry, I said that wrong. Branches that do not bear fruit will be cut off, removed from the vine, branches that do bear fruit will be pruned. Now, here's what you need to know there. This means both will be cut. There's a cutting involved in both. It is a untruth. It's a borderline heresy, maybe a flat-out heresy, this gospel of health and wealth, that everything is going to go well for you financially and health-wise and every way if you are truly following Christ, because no disease is in his will, so those truly following will never get sick, and they will always do well financially, and they'll be extremely good-looking, and their children will be way above average. The Bible doesn't say that at all. In fact, what it tells us is, along with following Christ comes persecutions. And with sickness, he told Timothy to take some medicine for his stomach ailments. It was not an issue that there should be no sickness in the body of Christ. We're still living in these cursed bodies, in this cursed world, with the Spirit of God living within us. Being cut means everything will not go well for you. Tornadoes may still hit your house. There will still be accidents. You will still get diseases. Things will happen that we did not plan on happening. That will sometimes seem devastating. But you know what the difference is? The cutting off is removing from the vine. The pruning is orchestrated by God for his purposes, and the ultimate purpose is always one purpose: more fruit born for his glory. So those things come for believers so that they will bear more fruit. They are acts of God in a sense. They are his doing so that we might grow and strengthen and be better prepared for those things. So who's the father in all this? The father is the vine dresser. He is the one orchestrating the entire operation. He strategically prunes. He guides and directs. This passage tells us his ultimate goal is to glorify himself, that because the fruit will be born. Now, you may look at that and say, well, that's a selfish God. Glorify yourself. This is God. This is the God who we spoke of earlier in the prayer that created this universe and every other realm of existence that we don't even see as fleshly people. He is the one who made it all for his glory. God cannot help but to be glorified. Being God glorifies him. What you need to know about him and his love is he did lower himself to our place for our benefit. That's his great love. But that ultimately increased his glory. That's what he is all about. And the ultimate purpose in our lives. If you want to know what the life of a Christian is all about, it's not to have the greatest life you can have with Jesus sitting next to you in it. It is that you may glorify God by bearing much fruit. That's what we're here for. That's what we exist for. So now we get down to the million-dollar question, because we have to sort of get practical with this. I can leave it right there and go, okay, but what does that mean? How do I do that? We are people that like to know how, aren't we? How exactly do I bear this fruit? Well, the first thing I'll tell you is you can't do anything. It's only the Spirit of God that can do it. However, he gives us some indications here of what this is all about, of what is involved in this. And one thing he says in verse 7 is this: if you abide in me and my words abide in you, we can stop right there. To abide in him is to have his words abide in us. What does that mean? Well, we can get practical with that one. When someone's words abide in you, what does that mean? That means you listen to them, you think about them, you take them to heart, you listen to them often, you saturate yourself in them, you absorb them so that those words will stay with you. This, friends, is why we emphasize Bible study, Bible reading, all those things in the Church of Jesus Christ. It is a key to abiding. To abide is to live in very, very intimate union with Jesus Christ. How do you do that without hearing from him? And this is the very word of God he's given to us. This is the self-disclosure of God. So this is why we encourage you to be regular readers of this Bible. We love people that read through their Bible in a year, although I would say that's not for everyone, because even better than reading through the Bible in a year is reading through in such a way that you don't get bogged down if you miss a few days, and you can stop in a passage and spend a great deal of time contemplating and mulling over and reading again certain smaller passages so that that word may abide in you. Sometimes reading through the Bible in a year becomes an exercise in reading from here to there. And if you miss a few days because of vacation or company or whatever, then you get behind and then you're in trouble because then you got to sit down for this massive reading. And even if you do it to accomplish 1 year, whatever value that is, you aren't really reading his scripture. You're just going da 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 da. To read his word in such a way that you are reading it in the spirit of, God, this is your voice. What are you saying to me today? What do you have for me today to learn about you, to learn about me, and to learn about what you would like for me to do in obedience to you? That's the good reading of God's word. That's why we encourage Bible studies, when people get together and do this very thing, and small groups to get together and do this very thing. That's why when we have church services, the exposition of scripture is the main thing we do, so that we can be abiding in his word, so his word can be abiding in us, because that's a key part of abiding in him. To know him. The next thing we see here is in the very same verse, where it says in verse 7, if you abide in me, my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. He introduces prayer now, the word of God and prayer. It says, if you're doing that, whatever you ask for, you're going to get. Why? Because you're going to be knowing the mind of God, because his word is abiding in you, because you know how he is and what he's thinking and how he would respond to things. I have a little thing I like to do when my wife and I go out to eat, and that is just sit back and think, okay, what is she going to order? What is Karen going to order? And I will tell you, I get it exactly right about 80% of the time. Now, am I that smart? Those of you who know me know, obviously, no, I'm not. But what is it? I know her. I know how she thinks. I know her. I can. Sometimes she says, I'm not even going to order. You know what I'm going to get. Go ahead and order it. So we do. How does that happen? Because we've been abiding. We've been intimately together. I listen to her. I talk to her. I know her. When I come and look at the menu, I say, Karen's going to get that, and she's going to take that for a side. 80%. It's pretty good because I know her. When he says, if my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you, your prayers are going to be answered because they're going to be prayers that know the mind and the heart of God. And this give and take is the very heart of this relationship. That's why we encourage prayer. I have come to realize a surprising, almost shocking number of Christians do not have an intimate, personal prayer life with Jesus Christ through his Spirit. Far too many prayers are relegated to grace at mealtime or maybe a little ditty before you go to bed, and not spending intimate time bearing your heart and soul before the one who knows you better than anybody else in the context of listening to him through his word and confessing your sins, which is a key part of this thing, part of that prayer life. What's the point of hiding them? He knows. Confessing them so that we can get them out on the table, so that he can cleanse us, so that he can work on us. I've told you beforehand, if you find some flaws in me and you come tell me, Pastor Bob, you have some weaknesses, my response will be, you're absolutely right, and you don't know the half of them. But me and God are working on it because we talk about that stuff. You can't tell me anything about me that's negative that I haven't already been talking to God about. I pretty much guarantee you. That's the kind of relationship we need to have. That intimacy in prayer, and then that work of the word within us to where it abides in us, to where, like I know what Karen is going to order, we come to a situation, we say, I know what God wants me to do here. I know what God wants me to do. And also, hearing those voices. You know, sometimes things happen that are not good, and this little voice of the enemy says, you should be angry at this person. You should be dwelling on this. Your feelings should be hurt. Then to recognize and say, wait a minute. That's not the voice of my God. The voice of my God says, love one another. It's not about me. It's about his love. So there's some practical things. This abiding life, the word of God. There's prayer, and then, of course, there is obedience. Look at verse 10. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. So you want to know how to abide? He has a direct statement there. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. So, obedience. I have learned that to the domesticated evangelical, obedience is a bad word. We say, wait a minute, it's about grace. You're talking about a work salvation now. It's not about obeying, it's just about believing. But what is true? What is belief without obedience? Can you say you believe that he is the Lord of your life and not obey him? Well, then what are these commandments? Is that the Ten Commandments? No, it's the commandments of Jesus in the day-by-day living, just as he obeyed his Father's commandments. They weren't chiseled in stone. They were the will of God that he knew because he was abiding and God was in him and he was in God. And now we are entered into that relationship through the Holy Spirit. And he tells us what his main commandment is, very consistently, that we love one another. That's a commandment. So the abiding life is being intimate with Jesus through his word, through prayer, so that we know him. And then when we know him, we say, this is what he would do. And therefore, we say, therefore, this is what I must do in this situation, because he is now living his life through me, the way God was, the Father was living his life through Jesus when he was here on earth, to where Jesus did nothing but the Father's will. That's the ultimate abiding. And do you know what he says about that in verse 11? These things I have spoken to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. Do you want the fullness of joy? It's not going to be getting the car you want or the house that you want or the toys that you want or the wife or husband that you want. Those things are all great. Do you want the ultimate joy? To be doing God's will by abiding in him. To be doing what you were created by him to do, the works that he prepared beforehand that you should walk in him, that glorify him, so that you are living a life that ultimately glorifies God. That's where we find the greatest of joy, the joy that lasts, not the temporary thing that's there with the new house until you find out that there are some issues with the house. Or you marry the perfect person and then you find out that this person was not as perfect as you thought they were. True joy is found in him. 12 through 17, this is my commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that you lay down your life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you slaves, for a slave does not know what the master is doing, but I have called you friends. For all things I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you would go and bear fruit, and that your fruit would remain, and whatever you ask my Father in my name, he may give you. This is my commandment, that you love one another. He makes it really quite plain what exactly we should be doing. I gave you a definition a few weeks back of what it means to be in Christ, in that union. I'm going to read that one again because I think it's a good one. The central reality of our salvation is that through faith, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we enter into a vital, personal, and profoundly real union with the incarnate, crucified, resurrected Savior, Jesus Christ, through whom all the blessings of salvation flow to us. It is a life of abiding in him, of recognizing who you are, not just someone who's become a member of the club by affirming the set of sayings that we're supposed to affirm in agreement. It is a new life with the very presence of God living within you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit now living their life on earth through you as their presence, which is why we're called the body of Christ, and finding the fullness of our joy as we obey him daily in our lives. Not to earn our salvation, because he has granted us a salvation we could not possibly earn. We're his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works that he prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. If we are abiding in him, we cannot help but do those works. So what's the need, brothers and sisters? To start working harder? To figure things out a little more and do a little better with what we're doing, like love each other better? Okay, try it, you'll fail. It's to draw close to him. It's to go to our Lord, to open his word and open it with new eyes, saying, what do you have for me? What are you showing me about you? What are you showing me about me? What are you showing me about what you would have me be doing in this life you are living through me? and through very intimate prayer, revealing your burdens, your hearts freely to Him, and allowing His Spirit to pull all those things together and produce in you the fruit that He created you to produce. This is the Christian life, friends. And it's not hard. It's easy, except for one thing. The only way you get there is to surrender yourself to Him. No longer me, but you. That's it. That's all you, as far as doing, that's all you do. You say, less of me, more of you. I'm not coming to my Bible for my benefit to see what I can get out of it. I'm not coming to church because I really get a lot out of the service. I'm coming into the presence of the people that know God like I know God and who are there to teach me how to love. This is it in all its simplicity. This is what Jesus said as He was on His way to Gethsemane. There's one more thing we'll look at, and that'll be next week when we will conclude our summer series on our union with Christ, His final prayer about His disciples that He offers that will absolutely blow you away. Let's pray.